Changing the world. are unshakable, Lord. You're the Alpha and the Omega, Lord. You're the Creator. You're the beginning and the end of all things, Lord God. Lord, as we are here tonight, God, just open up our hearts, Lord. Just soften us, Lord. Soften our spirits. And let us pour out, Lord, anything that might be just in the way of you just ministering to us, Lord God, for the words that you have for us to hear tonight, Jesus. Lord, we're here to hear a message of hope. And the biggest hope we can have is the resurrection, Lord God, of your Son, Jesus. For it's in him that we have eternal life, Lord God. And it's in his name that we pray tonight.
For them to share with you this evening in your time of prayer. It's a time to bring anything to him, any type of healing you need, body, mind, and spirit, anything you've got going on in your life that's bothering you, whatever it is, God is here to hear your prayers this evening. And we're here to help you and to lift that up with you. The other thing I wanted to mention before I hand it over to Mike for the message is that keep in mind, we're doing these on a bi-monthly basis, and so our next one will be the second Sunday of November, which I believe is November 9th. So watch your bulletin so we can see you back again in November. Without further ado, I'll turn it over to Mike, who's going to share a wonderful message with us tonight.
All right. Am I on? Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. Praise the Lord. Welcome to Connection. What a blessing to be here on Sunday evening. What a blessing to be here with God and with each other. Why don't we pray? Father, we are thankful, ever thankful, Lord, each day of our lives that you are with us, you never abandon us. You are truly our hope. Tonight, as we talk about hope being the answer for despair and depression, Lord, we would just ask that you would reveal yourself to us, that the you that is within us that we're not even aware of, and maybe for some of us tonight it would be the first time that you're revealed. And boy, I remember that day in my life so fondly, Lord. So wherever we are tonight, we come to you. We ask that you bless this time in service and in time of communion and prayer, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
How is everyone tonight?
Good.
All right. You know, in my heart recently, there's been this message that God has been giving me. It just comes from living, right? We all have experiences in life, and when you're sensing God working through your life and in your life and around your life, he just builds things in you. And this is something that I felt like I really needed to share tonight. So my message tonight is called Hope, Overcoming Despair and Depression. And so I want to read a little bit about a couple articles that talk about despair and depression here. Articles that have been out over the last year or so. It says, according to a CNNHealth.com article titled, Antidepressants, Most Prescribed Drugs in the U.S., it is stated that antidepressants prescribe more than drugs for high blood pressure, high cholesterol, asthma, or headaches. So, I know in our family, you know, ibuprofen and Tylenol go a long way for headaches, and we've had our share of headaches. So when I multiply that by the number of families in America, think how many aspirin I'm taking, and then start thinking about how many antidepressants are being taken. It's a lot. The article discusses how doctors are prescribing antidepressants to just help people feel better about themselves without offering any changes to the patient's life. That, I think, is tragic. It is stated that in this article that 25% of all adults will have at least one major depressive episode at some time in their life. Causes for depression vary in our lives, and so do the effects. The effects can range from mild thoughts of discouragement that we just can't shake to moderate feelings of being overwhelmed. Just completely overwhelmed by life's daily circumstances. The most severe cases can cause us to feel insignificant and unable to change the outcome of our lives. And I would think that many of us have been at a place at a point in time when we felt like we had no control. Nothing I've done seems to make a difference. My ability is insignificant. I'm almost insignificant in my life. And this is one of the most severe cases, the way we feel insignificant and that we can't, you know, change the outcome of our lives. And for many, this leaves us unable to function with daily tasks, which can cause so much pain that we end up giving up and just stop caring. Now, I don't know if you've ever felt that kind of pain in your life, where you just want to give up. You just seem to, you can't care anymore, because if you care, it just keeps hurting. So you stop caring. And then finally, depression, despair can be so bad, sometimes the severe effects lead to suicide. There was an article in May 2013, last year, by the Washington's blog that says that the current suicide rates in America are higher now than they were during the Great Depression. And that's pretty bad. The article states that the number of suicides in America has surpassed the number of deaths by car accidents on an annual basis. And, also very disturbing, more soldiers die by suicide than die in battle. I have personally struggled with, you know, trying to ward off the effects of despair and depression from my life. As a child, I grew up in a home with addiction problems, divorce, violence. As an adult, I've experienced divorce, the loss of a parent, the loss of a job, significant health issues with my eyesight. Some of you know part of my testimony, where they took my left eye out of my head, fixed it, put a band around it, put it back in, and I was blind for a couple of months until my sight came back. It was very disturbing for me to go through that. I struggled with that. I wondered if I would be handicapped in some way for the rest of my life because of that. But, well, I can see everyone. However, this is my reading eye. I closed that eye. Now I can see all of you better with my distance eye. So I've got this weird thing going on here. You're all 50% in focus. Yeah, with my glasses I can see it perfectly, but then I can't read. So I'll just go with it here. But also my wife Maria, she went through open heart surgery to replace the main valve in her heart. And that was 7 years ago. Maria and I have experienced difficult challenges in our life. One child who seemed to do everything to make our life miserable. But God has been faithful, and He's doing so much better. But boy, oh boy, God wanted to teach us and him too. We also have struggled with significant financial challenges through the years. Some of that due to medical expenses, some of that due to employment loss, some of that due to legal fees, and some of that just due to the everyday cost, the high cost of living. Even at Walmart, things are getting a little expensive. So, you know, these are things that maybe in your life you've experienced some things, or even now, while you may be struggling with despair or depression, the things of your life that are really trying to beat you down, trying to make you give up. It hurts. You're not sure you can make it. You've done everything you know to do. Nothing seems to change. The one child that we had all these blessings with for years and years and years, you know, it seemed like it would never change. And each time we hoped for change, and it did change, it changed for the worse. How about you? Have you gone through anything? Are you going through anything? Maybe in your, with your health or your finances, relationships? How about family, friends, your job situation? Where are you at? Where have you been? Often, what we'll do is we place our trust in our jobs, in our money, our bank accounts, in our things, our possessions, in our relationships, in our favorite teams. Fly, Eagles, fly! Yeah. Right? This is a statistic. I had a couple cop friends. Violence, domestic violence, increases dramatically from football season on Saturdays and Sundays. There are a group of people who place a lot of trust in their teams or in family or in government to make our lives better, to make us happy and bring peace in our lives. See, this is the world's way. Accumulate, trust in. Maybe one of the things that is most harmful in our lives. You'll have to listen through the rest of this to understand what I mean by this. It's putting trust in ourselves. I've got this. I can do this. I'm able. I'm good. I remember one night, and I don't know if you remember this, it was actually on our honeymoon, so I hope you remember. Well, probably don't remember this part of it. But it was late at night. We were at a hotel in a resort, and pretty much the streets were mostly empty. This just came in the snub the nose. And I hear this arguing outside, so I go out to the balcony, and there's this young man who was, I think he was drunk and high or whatever, just with another guy that's coming down the sidewalk. And got in an argument, gave this guy a hard time, and the guy, boom, knocked him right to the ground, and I said, I am God. I have a brother who now attends church here, who on the phone told me a few years ago, very angry at me, and said, I was trying to share the love of God with him. He said, I am God. ourselves. That's the world's way. It is not God's way. There is an answer to despair and depression in our lives. Doctors, bankers, psychologists, relationships, they can't provide these things. There's a place for all of these things in our lives. There's a reason for them and a place for them and a time for them. But they are not the answer to despair and discouragement. They're not the answer to depression. The answer is hope. How can hope be the answer to such devastating feelings and emotions and thoughts of overwhelming, just being overwhelmed and beat down in life? Well, hope, the hope that only God can give us through Jesus Christ, is that answer. Romans 15, 13 says this. Every time I'm up here, I say this is one of my most favorite scriptures. But every time I read more scriptures, that's the most famous, most favorite scripture I have. And so for tonight, this is one of my favorites. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. There is so much in just that one verse. It is so amazing. What is being offered tonight is hope by trusting in the right relationship with God through Jesus Christ. The right prescription for despair and depression in our lives is the power of the Holy Spirit. And let me say this. It doesn't matter where you are. I come from a drug and alcohol addiction background, and it was in that place that I received Christ and I received hope. And if in our lives today, if we are prescribed an antidepressant and we are taking one, that doesn't matter. It's okay, because God is greater in our lives than what the world has to offer. And that's what we're saying. No matter where we are, no matter what we're going through, God is the one who gives us the hope to cause us to overcome. I can say that I know many people who are now not self-medicating with drugs, or self-medicating with alcohol, or self-medicating with food, or self-medicating with sex, or self-medicating with exercise, or self-medicating or having doctors medicate them once they got this power. It is an awesome power for us. It's an awesome power in our lives. So Proverbs 13:12 says this, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. Hope deferred, wait, and you wait for that change. You wait for things to work out. You're constantly waiting. That can really get heavy at times, can it? What are you waiting for? Your spouse to come around? Your kids to come around? For you to finally kick that habit? For a job to come along? What is it that you're waiting for? Where is your hope for tonight? Tonight, God wants to offer you a longing fulfilled. When we find our hope, not in those things we are waiting to change, but in the one who can change those things, we find a strength, we find a victory, we find a freedom that we've never known before. This is the hope of God. God has created each one of us with a longing to be in relationship with Him. We are all looking for love. As very famous song says, in the wrong place. And another song says, if you can't find the one you love, God didn't even know He was talking about God. Love the one you're with, and then the next one you're with, and then the next one you're with, and the next one you're with, until you don't even love yourself anymore. in that relationship with God. It is only in that relationship that we can have a hope that doesn't let us down. I'm going to read Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, and then we'll talk about that a little bit. I changed my mind. This is my new favorite verse. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, now I'm going to blow your minds with this, okay, you ready? Hold on to your ears because it's going to come oozing out in a moment. Not only do we hope in the glory of God, but we also glory in tribulations. Yay, I lost my job. Yay, the cops have called to come pick up the kid again. Yay, I got to get my eyeball taken out of my head in a hurry. Yay, the bills are late. Again this month. I don't see you guys jumping for joy here. But not only that, but we glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope.
Amen.
Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Five verses here. Five verses. The first verse, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. There is our peace in life. If my peace only comes when all my ducks are lined up in a row. Right, Gerda? When all my ducks are lined up in a row, I have very little peace, don't I? Verse 2, which is wonderful. Through whom also we have access by faith. Say, I have access.
I have access.
By faith.
By faith.
Okay, so no excuses. God gave you the key to this one. You have access by faith into this grace in which you now stand. The grace doesn't have to be someday. The grace is today. Get that? What a wonderful grace that is. And rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. The grace is today. The hope that someday in heaven, here's the thing, and he didn't put it in here, but he told me one day in prayer, that the house he's building for you in heaven, it comes without a mortgage payment. Yeah, nice, isn't that great? No mortgage payment. And I keep saying, Maria, I hope it comes on the 30th so we don't have to make the mortgage payment on the 1st. You know? There we go. We're out of here, Lord. What a great glory that's going to be someday. But what about today? What about now? This is where we live, right? What about now? And here's the now in verses 3 and 4. And not only that I can say, you know, go to heaven, praise God, we worship, we praise, we have fellowship, you know, we look forward to it, we argue over, is he coming before the tribulation, in the tribulation, at the end of the tribulation, you know, all that's great, but here's the here and now. And not only that, or then, but we also glory in tribulations. This is the here and now, isn't it? You have tribulations? Have you been through tribulations? This is it. Here and now. But that produces. Without tribulations, there would be a lack of production of the character and nature of God that he's putting within us, which is perseverance, character itself, and character produces hope, godly hope. I don't have to hope the market stays good to be okay financially. Let me clarify that. I can have hope when the market isn't good and when my bank accounts aren't great. I can still have hope. I'm going to be okay, and so are you. That's the here and now in verse 5. We are not put to shame by sufferings, but experience God's love through the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we think that all we're going through, I must have did something wrong. I kid. When things are going good in my life, or when someone says, oh, your wife is such a great cook, which she is, I say, I must have done something good in my last life, because this life, I'm not so sure. But the reality is, not all of our sufferings and our despair and our depression is our fault, is it? So we are experiencing life. Sometimes things that are out of our control are the very things that are causing us to struggle. It's not all that way. And we'll talk about Jesus in the garden in just a few moments. Think of all that he went through. What did he do wrong to deserve this struggle, this tribulation, this trial? I'm not, that's a hard one, right? He did nothing wrong. And yet he went through it. So hope in God gives us power over all despair and depression. 1 Corinthians 13:13 says this. In 1 Corinthians 13, and Stephanie, the songs were so right on tonight, the message reaffirming the Word of God, came from the Word of God. The love chapter. Why is the love chapter was written for one reason only, so we all have something to put into a marriage suit, right? We have a plaque on our wall someone gave us as a gift on our wedding day. It's the love chapter. Oh, I love you, baby. Right? That's not what the love chapter is about. The love chapter is about power. It's about dominating over the enemy in your life. It's about being strong in him. Love, and I'm a power guy. Come down to my basement, you'll see the weights. I'm always exercising and jumping around and trying not to get old and, you know. Played sports my whole life, screamed at the TV on Saturdays and Sundays. But I'm not one of the guys the cops have. Yeah, if my team loses. But I believe in power. God's given us power. And that power is this chapter. It's love. Now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Faith is what we give God. We give him our lives. We place our trust in him and we have faith. We give it to him. In return, he gives us hope. The someday hope of heaven. But he gives us hope for now, to live this life victoriously. There's a great song out now. We don't have to just survive. We were made to thrive. Are you thriving? Are we thriving? We're challenged to thrive, but we were made to thrive day in and day out. And then finally, of the three, faith, hope, comes love. And love is the power that overcomes despair and depression. Love is the power that takes away all fear in our lives. That last song had spoke of how love takes away fear. How does love take away fear? And what does fear have to do with hope? Keeping hope and having hope. Let's look at this. In 1 John chapter 4, I'm going to read verses 16 through 18. It says, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. So, I abide in God, yourself. I abide in God. God abides in me. So, I abide in God, God abides in me. Verse 17 says, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as He is, so are we in this world. Does that sound arrogant? Memorize that verse and say it to your pastor. Say it to your friends. What is this verse saying? Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Do we fear the judgment of God? If there is some fear within us of the judgment of God, then there is some lack of understanding of the love of God. Jesus took our judgment, and God had shown us His love and confirmed with us His love when He sent the Holy Spirit into our lives when we received Christ to seal that deal, so that we would know God abides with us and that we abide with Him. That is a done deal. So that we can have boldness in the day of judgment, I'm sure it's going to go something like this. Oh Lord. And He's going to say, rise up. You've been forgiven. You are my child. You're my son. You are my daughter. There's no judgment here for you. For the believer, our works will be judged, but we will not. So we're striving to do right and live righteously. And those things will be judged, but we will not, because God loves us. We are His favorite children. Say, I'm God's favorite child. Because as He is, so are we in this world. How is it that you and I are like Jesus in this world? Not in the world to come, in this world. It is that we are God's chosen children, the ones He loves. In the way that He loved Jesus and didn't abandon Jesus. Jesus went to the cross. He went through the cross. You'd think, here's a guy that did it all right, and he had to go through that? But let's look at the next verse and talk about that for a moment. There is no fear in love. Say that with me. There is no fear in love. But perfect love, which is God, casts out fear. Because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. So that last verse talks about all of this, doesn't it? Don't we all fear? I know I fear. But let me say this. The fear that I had 33 years ago is not what I have today. I have much less fear in my life. And the fears that I do have now, I can take them on. Jesus was tempted by fear. The Bible says Jesus was tempted in every way, even like we were, yet without sin. He was tempted by fear. He didn't succumb to fear. What am I saying? I'm saying in the Garden of Gethsemane, the night before His crucifixion, and He's praying, He knows what's coming. Think about you being Him and tomorrow being that day. Would you stop in here for 2 hours tonight? Or would you be calling all of your family and loved ones to say goodbye? Or would you be on a bus hightailing it out of town? So the local middle town police don't round you up to execute you tomorrow. He said 3 times, Father, wasn't struggling with that, wasn't weighing heavy on him, but in the end, because he knew his father loved him, that they were one, that even if he had to go through what he had to go through, he was going to be okay. Even then, because he knew that, fear did not grip him. He didn't get up and say, "Wake up, guys. We're headed back across the Jordan. I ain't having any of this. We'll come back when things settle down politically here." He stayed. He obeyed. He overcame. And he walked in the grace in which we stand in today. The grace that he stood in that night and that next day is the grace that we read in Romans about standing in today. That's the grace we have tonight. I don't know what you're going through or what you've been through, but what I'm telling you is, with God, in his grace, with that hope of now and the future, you can have power to get through without despair, without discouragement, without depression. And God may deliver you from antidepressants, from drugs, from alcohol, from whatever it takes for you to get through a day or even to get up out of bed some days. God is the strength to get out of bed. And eventually, as we draw near to him and we get this revelation, the strength to get out of bed, even though at 54, I gotta make my ankles move a little bit before I step on the floor, you know. Getting older, physically I don't have the same strength. Spiritually, I am way stronger than I used to be. Man, I'm ready to kick the devil's butt when I get up in the morning. But believe me, some mornings when I get up, the first thing he does is try to kick mine. You better be strong. You better have hope. And tonight, that's what's being offered here. The hope that comes from God that alleviates all fear. You name your fears. You know your fears. Tonight, when we pray, if you want to ask for prayer, if you want to mention those fears, if you want to mention the despair or the depression or the things that you're struggling with, please do. We want to pray with you. About those very things, we want to beat up on the enemy tonight. We want to get free. All of us want to be free, and we want to get free. So tonight, bring your fear, bring your despair, bring your depression to God. Let him replace it with hope and love. Love. Hope is the fearless power of God, found in Jesus Christ, given through the Holy Spirit that lives in each believer. Maybe tonight, I don't know all of you, I know most of you, but if you're not sure about your relationship with God, get sure tonight. Simply, when you're with us, ask God, tell us, I want God to be my Savior. I want him in my life. I want the fullness of hope and the power of love. And they'll pray with you to receive Christ. And then we can pray for whatever else you want tonight. Amen? Let's pray. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you've given us faith, hope, and love. We give faith tonight to you, by bringing our lives to you, by bringing everything in our lives to you. We give hope tonight. We receive hope tonight. And Lord, we want to just live in your love and experience all that you have for us. Bless the communion. Bless the prayer tonight. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Thank you, Mike. As we transition into our communion time, I just want to take a few moments to just kind of make you familiar with how we're going to move through the rest of the evening. Lori, in just a moment, Pastor Lori Brown will be coming in to start us into our communion service with the words and the prayers and such as we prepare our hearts to really come to the Lord's table. And we'll be taking communion very similar to what we do on Sunday mornings by intention, kind of hand open for the bread, dip it into the cup and that type of thing. So very similar. After you do that, you can go ahead to a prayer station that might be open or to the steps for prayer. If a prayer station isn't open once you've taken communion, you can linger near that prayer station or go to your seats and wait for a prayer station to be available, however you feel most comfortable. We do ask, as far as communion being served, the prayer team, we will invite them to take first so that we can also partake in the communion just prior to you and be ready at our stations for when you come out as you're led by the Holy Spirit. We do have the gluten-free option tonight, so if you want the gluten-free option, just let the communion servers know. We're ready. Our prayer team is ready. Our healing prayer team is praying about this week, during the week. We've been praying for each other. We're just ready with the power of the Holy Spirit to just minister to whatever your needs are this evening. You may come to the communion, come to the prayer stations. If you want to sit in the chair, that's fine. If you're more comfortable standing, just let us know. And the other thing we wanted to let you know is sometimes there's things that maybe you just, as a woman, you just want to pray with a couple of women. Men, you just want to pray with a couple of men. We do have an all-male team that will be over at this prayer station, and the all-female teams will be the two prayer stations at the front. So if you're more comfortable with whatever your prayer need is tonight, but come expectant. Come with an open heart and an open mind. He wants to heal your body, mind, and spirit. He also wants to take care of whatever your troubles are. Know that the Holy Spirit is here with us, and some things we like to explain as a healing prayer team is that sometimes you will hear people praying in tongues. God has put the Spirit on us, and we feel like we want to pray in a way where the Holy Spirit is just pouring out through us. It's just a way, it's a prayer language that God has given us, a gift, one of those gifts of the Spirit. And, you know, just relax in the Spirit. You know that we are there. We're going to have intercessors at each of the prayer teams as well as the prayer ministers, and also intercessors will be at the back intercessing for you as well, just really asking the Spirit into this time to really minister to you. And without further ado, I'll hand it over to Lord.
So now we have an awesome opportunity to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion. And after Holy Communion, you know, at the prayer stations, we also have an opportunity to be anointed, just as the apostles anointed, you know, the folks for healing and various things. You have an opportunity to do that. We have oil up here, and we'll just place a symbol of the cross on your forehead as a symbol of the Holy Spirit and God's anointing and healing in your life. So this is a great opportunity for us to just receive. These are ordinary elements of bread, juice, and oil, and it's what, you know, God does with them that really makes them extraordinary. So let's begin communion, which is a means of God's grace into our lives, that when we come to receive. So when Jesus was there with his disciples, they were sharing in the Passover meal, in that Last Supper. And Jesus, that night, he took bread, as was custom, and he gave thanks for you and to God, and he blessed it. And then after he blessed it, he broke the bread, and he said some new words that they hadn't heard before. He said, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat, as often as you can in remembrance of me." After the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, the juice, the fruit of the vine, and he said, "Drink from this, to the table, you know, everyone is invited to this table. This table is for all people, nations, ages, races. And we have an open communion table here at Connection Community Church. So all are welcome. All who want more of God in their life. All who want more of this love and hope of God that Mike talked about. So we invite all who love God and want more of His life. This communion table is for you. These are hands and feet, servants, but Christ is the host of this meal. Before we come to the meal, we want to kind of do some cleansing. I use some hand sanitizer as a symbol of cleansing, but we really want to cleanse our heart. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer of confession, where we can talk to God about those things that are in the way in our life, in the way of our relationship, that are barriers to our relationship with God and to other people. So during this prayer of confession, I'll start it, and then you can talk to God about those things in your life that you want to lift up and confess to God. And there will be no surprises. So God already knows what's going on. It's just really good for us to confess that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, wow. We come to you as sinners. Lord, we mess up and we make mistakes, so we just want to take a moment to talk to you about those things in our lives that are in the way of our relationship with you. Lord, hear our prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. That's the good news. Amen. Amen. So let us pray. Holy Spirit, I just pray that you would pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice and oil, that they would be a means of grace and opening to your love in our hearts, Lord. That they would help draw us closer to you, Lord. And we pray for your healing and your wholeness. Amen. So, as Lisa said, we're going to ask the prayer team to come forward first so that they can receive and get into the prayer stations. We're going to have about this prayer time. This is time for you to pray too. You can pray on the steps, you can pray in your seats. We're going to take about 15 minutes of prayer time now. And after you receive communion, you can go to one of the prayer stations. At the end of the evening, if we close and you still have, we're not going to leave here tonight until every person has received prayer, but we will end this in about 15 minutes for those who need to go. So these are the gifts of God for the people of God. The prayer team can now come forward and receive. You are blessed.